So let's talk about data dependencies. And by data dependencies, I mean something very akin to code dependencies. When we write software code, we want to include as few external dependencies as possible. Same thing happens with machine learning models. We want to include as few data dependencies as we can. Now, by data dependencies, I of course mean our input features that we use for training and for prediction. Our input features are important because they determine our system behavior. If our features change, our system behavior will change as well. Now, in software engineering land, we know how to test code. But features basically take the place of code in our machine learning systems. And we don't necessarily have a great analog for unit tests of data. So we need to be very careful and basically go through a checklist to make sure that we're including features that are useful and will not hurt our system in the long term. The first question is this piece of data reliable? Which is that, is this signal that I'm incorporating going to always be produced in the same way whenever I need it? Now, in some cases, an upstream signal might be flaky. Maybe it comes from some server that is only available 95% of the time. If it's not available, we need to have a fallback plan. Maybe it looks like an indicator feature that shows that that signal was not available as a Boolean. We need to think about, is that feature going to change on us over time? And do we need to think about the versions of it? It's easy to imagine that we might have a signal that comes from some upstream model or some upstream process that changes over time. Whenever possible, it's good for us to either have a version number imported to us so we can know when that upstream signal changes, or to actually take ownership of a copy of that signal and only update that signal on our own schedule. We want to think about the necessity of these features. Oftentimes, as machine learning people, we get really excited about improving the accuracy or the quality of our model, and we end up finding sort of areas of diminishing returns where we add a tiny little epsilon of benefit at the cost of one or two or 10 different external features that we're now depending on. And we want to really weigh these costs carefully. Are we getting enough bang for the buck when we add in a new feature to really pay for the long-term maintenance costs that we're adding to our system? We also want to think about correlations. Is this feature, in fact, something that we'd think is causal, or is it just something that happens to be correlated, and would we know if those correlations changed? Now, one way that we might tease apart these correlations is by injecting randomness into our system to sometimes tease apart these things. This sort of randomization is an important strategy. We need to think about feedback loops. As we said before, we'd like to make sure that we don't have non-stationarity in our system. The easiest way to get non-stationarity is to have our input data depend on the outputs of our model. Now, this can happen in interesting ways. One of my favorite examples is in the world of stock market prediction. You might have two stock market prediction models from two entirely different firms. If one of these prediction models has bugs, it might cause stock market prices to go up on a certain stock. The model from the other firm, from firm B, might be looking at this and will learn from that data and may also exhibit changed behavior. So the bugs from system A may in fact change the behavior of bugs from system B, even though those systems are completely disjoint and are in fact from completely different companies. So feedback loops are a real thing, and we need to find ways to track them down and account for them.